So far away.
Yeah.
We didn't use these before. We used the mics, right?
Yeah. Yes. Everyone attached.
Yes. Cool. Hi, everybody. It's a nice Tuesday morning. Missed you guys last week in voting. Of course, it was super cold, so that was probably a blessing. It was very icy and very cold. All right, so we're just going to jump right in and just get started with prayer. Okay, I will introduce myself after I pray. I need God to bless that too.
Okay.
All right. Dearly Father, I'm just so thankful for this time, as always, Lord, that you would just let us be here together in this room and talk about you and talk about your goodness and your holiness and who you are, and that we have the opportunity to do that. I'm just so grateful and thankful that you use the vessels here to be able to pour into us, that we may share that. And I just pray that you would bless this lesson, Lord, is, oh, I know you've worked on me, you've worked on my heart, God, and all of the things that you do in my life, Lord, and I'll just say it openly that please just forgive me, Lord, if there's things in my life that may block the Holy Spirit from just coming through, Lord, that I do ask your forgiveness and repent of any of those unseen things in my life that you may be glorified. And I just pray for this day, and I pray that you would be glorified and magnified in who you are, and that we would just walk out with a clear vision of your truth again and in your word, in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
So I can't move very far, I guess. Okay. I don't love the angle, Brandy. It's not a great angle. It's really way up, right? Well, my name is Bethany. I've been a part of Pursue for about 8 years, something like that. I have been lecturing for a few years. I haven't lectured since the summer, which was new for us in the park, but that was pretty cool, right?
Yeah.
That was a good time. I really enjoyed that. And God is good, and God is always faithful. And so that was really cool to see some of those things come to fruition. Oh, hi. Your glasses are so cute. Are they real? I love it. I got cute glasses on, sorry. So yeah, I have kids, I have a husband, I have a mortgage. I've been in the Chicago area for 8 years, about the same time. So
Chicago.
Anyway, huh?
Chicago area.
Oh, sorry, I am from the Chicago area. I'm here. Are you? Oh yeah, we've talked about this, right? Cool. We had I'm now a part-time teacher at my school. That's super new for me. So we were doing a contest, and I asked who has the best socks on. And one of the kids was like, "Say that again." I said, "Socks." "Say that again." I said, "What are you getting at? What are we talking about?" So apparently that's so yes, all right. So today we're going to be talking about John 5. And what I have labeled on the top is the cultivating a true culture. And part of this goes back to my new experience as a teacher. It's super fun and it's super exciting. And when you have these beautiful young little minds to mold, and you realize you don't get anything, you don't understand it. And I was laying down some of my best stuff, like my second day. I was laying it down, and they're like, "We don't understand what you're saying." And I was like, "Pursue would."
Yeah.
I was like, "Pursue would get it." I'm talking just these deep truths about God, and I told him, "Just let it sink in then. Just take it in and let it flow in there, and hopefully you'll grab something good." All right. So this is something that I think that we all can identify with in our Christian walk, as we're talking about the culture and about truth and about what's not truth. So let's just go ahead to our chapter 5. Let's refer to the end of it. Let's start at chapter 5, verse 31. I'm going to read that out loud. And this is Jesus talking. He says, "If I alone bear witness of myself, my testimony is not true. There is another who bears witness of me, and I know that the testimony which he bears of me is true. You have sent to John, and he has borne witness to the truth, and the witness which I receive is not from man, but I say these things that you may be saved. He was the lamp that was burning and was shining, and you were willing to rejoice for a while in his light. But the witness which I have is greater than that of John, for the works which the Father has given me to accomplish, The very works that I do bear witness of me that the Father has sent me. And the Father who sent me, he has borne witness of me, and you have neither heard his voice at any time nor seen his form. And you did not have his word abiding in you, for you do not believe him who he sent. You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. And it is these that bear witness of me. And you are willing to come to me that you may have life. I do not receive glory from men, but I know you, that you do not have the love of God in yourselves. I have come in my Father's name, and you do not receive me. If another shall come in his own name, you will receive him. And can you believe when you receive glory from one another, and you do not seek the glory that is from the one and only God? Do not think that I will accuse you before the Father. The one who accuses you is Moses, and whom you have set your hope. For if you believed Moses, you would believe in me. He wrote about me, but if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe in my words? I found that terribly interesting. Jesus always has the most amazing, I mean, he's Jesus, but what he's saying to these people is what they have an issue with is not that this miraculous thing that Jesus did and healed this man of an infirmity of 38 years, but their issue is that they told him to take up his bed. So when I'm looking at this and I'm reading at it, I'm thinking we have an issue way back then and all the way back to the beginning of time of truth, of very simply of what truth is. So I was thinking about it, and I was wondering about absolute truths, about what do people really feel about absolute truth? Because when we're here at Pursue, we're talking to Christians, right? We're talking to fellow Christians that we're in it, we're reading the word, we believe it. But I was wondering about the influences that come in the culture of our children and who we are, which there are so many out there. Let me just tell you, I mean, I've been a teacher for about a minute, and realizing the pressure on our kids to believe some of these crazy philosophical things and people and what they believe is so heavy and so burdensome that really what we need to be doing, it's not only getting involved, but praying for our kids. We need to pray for our kids on our knees like we believe it. So I was looking at different quotes of kind of what people thought about absolute truths. Gandhi said, "Nobody in the world possesses absolute truth. This is God's attribute alone. Relative truth is all we know. Therefore, we can only follow the truth as we see it. Such pursuits of truth cannot lead anyone astray." What do you think about that? I mean, that sounds relative to today, a lot of what people are thinking today. But again, remember, sometimes we don't think that cultures and ideas seep in, but they do, especially with people around us. Here's another one. I don't know if this is a newer religion. There was a lot of important people, if you would say, that, you know, like, not important people, but celebrities. I think it's called Baha'i?
Yeah.
Oh, you guys know it. I mean, me too. I know about it.
Yeah.
Their slogan, part of what they have in their literature, is that religious truth is not absolute but relative. The divine revelation is a continuous and progressive process, that all the great religions of the world are divine in origin, that their basic principles are complete harmony, and their aim, purpose are one and the same, and their teachings are but facets of one truth, that their functions are complementary, that they differ only in the non-essential aspects of their doctrine, and their missions represent successive stages in the spiritual evolution of human society. What do you think about that?
Gobbledygook.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. But here's the thing.
Good words, but
right.
Yeah.
When we boil down what we really believe, what the truth is, and this is the whole point. When I was reading in John, when I was reading some of these other things, and in Christian circles, I think it's so easy to be deceived. It's easy to be deceived by our own wants, maybe even our own ignorance. And so I'm thinking of this as I was talking to you all and praying over it, and had about 5 lecture windows up. I had all kinds of different things going. This is what I landed on. This is what you guys are getting to today. But that's the purpose of what I want to walk away with. I really want to solidify the absolutes of Jesus Christ. What do we know for sure that we can stand in? And what it's going to come down to is who we can stand in. Not the exacts and the this and the that, but what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about Jesus. So the first part of there is God's absolute. And absolute, there were several definitions that I had looked up, but this is the one that I landed on, was free from imperfection or limitation, complete and unadulterated. So when we're talking about Jesus, we're talking about God and his absolutes. This is the definition that we're going to be using. So the first one, the very first thing, when we want to know who God is and what he says and what can I rest on, is the inerrant and authoritative word of God. And on that, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. The next verse is, for the word of the Lord is right, and his words are done in truth. And so when I was thinking of how do we create a culture of truth around us, I thought about a lot of times that we have to know what the truth is. And as a church, I think sometimes we have, we get into the garden effect, when Satan asks the question, did God really say that? How many times do we take the truth of the Bible when we ask, is that really what God said? Is that really what he meant? And this is part of what I'm doing in my class, which I find to be incredibly convicting, is when kids will say things, and I do this myself, and they'll say, well, this is what God said. What do I say? Chapter and verse. Give me the chapter and verse, please. And they're like, we don't know what that means. So we have to break it down. Give me the chapter and give me the verse. Because if we do not cultivate a biblical worldview out of these things that we see, we won't know it. So, and I think that as I know I do it, I think it's hard, that deception to say, well, and we were just talking about it a bit ago, that we try to interpret what God said. Instead of letting, you know, the creator of the world, the person who sustains our very breath and our body, speak for himself, we think that we might know a little bit better on a personal level. Well, let me explain it to you. Maybe God said this. So that's the very first part that we have to, that I think that is so essential. And I do it. I think that that's our tendency, is to think in our flesh that we might be able to explain this instead of going, you know what? Chapter and verse. What did God say? And can I rest on not what God said or how? That's it. I don't have to interpret it. I don't have to defend it. What I have to do is I have to live for it. So that's part of our first absolute in creating that culture. And I wrote this down. It's one thing not to live in God's truth or make mistakes or make bad decisions. That's what grace, forgiveness, and sanctification are for. But it's an entirely different thing to do all of those things and claim to be at peace and incongruent with God's word. What I mean by that is I don't know or understand as Christians why we can't just call good good and bad bad. You know what? We make mistakes. We do dumb things. We do selfish things. We act out of our flesh. Why do we have to justify it? Do you think as a Christian culture, as we're together, that we might be fortified in truth if we just called it for what it was? If we just called truth, truth. And you know what? I messed up. And God's like, that's so great because I have grace for that. And you know what? I made the bad choice. It's like, that's awesome. Because in the sanctification process, I am right here with you. That's why I died. That's why I love you. Because I am willing to work with you. But the problem is, do you think that we don't do that because we don't necessarily want to stop what we're doing? We don't necessarily want to change our life. However, we do want to live at peace with ourselves. So in order to live at peace with ourselves, and not the lifestyle or the truth that God wants us to do, we have to change it, which is my favorite term, cognitive dissonance. Something has to give. So, in part of that, again, with the inerrancy and authority of the Word of God, we have to believe that. Because what's happening in our culture, when we're talking about God, the absolutes, and be able to create this culture of honesty and truth, is we don't really reference it sometimes. I do it. Sometimes we sit, we talk in Christian circles, and we have ideas and we have thoughts, and how many times are Bible verses brought up? How many times are the truth of what he says brought up? Just as he said it. And a lot of times we begin to talk and we go, you know what? Is that really what happened? Did God really say that? We just had a 45-minute conversation. I'm not even really sure if that's exactly what God said. And so I think that it's very simple, and I think that's how God meant some of it to be with this. Like, we always have to be on our guard. We always have to be ready to understand what God wants for us and to listen to the Holy Spirit. But part of it is him saying, I gave you my word. I gave it to you. You read it and you believe it. And the second part of the absolutes are his attributes. And for his invisible attributes, namely, his eternal power and divine nature has been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that has been made. Somebody give me some attributes of God. We studied this several summers ago, I believe. I tell them I can wait. Okay, come on, give me some more. Okay, yes. So we have all these, this is the self-existing God. He's omnipotent, he knows everything, he's all power, he is complete grace, he's complete just, he's merciful. We know these are absolutes. That means you can take it to the bank of who God is and who he is all around. He is absolutely just and he is absolutely merciful at the same time. He's absolutely sovereign. So as we're talking about these things, again, I keep going back to knowing his word, but in the attributes of God, I have to know his character. And that's the second one, the third one is the character, that God is the true source of the Bible, so his character determines the credibility of the whole book. If God's character is on trial or unreliable, so is the Bible. If who he is and who he says he is not able to stand, then neither can the Bible. So what does this mean for his character of love and grace and mercy? And I think sometimes as a culture, we try to rewrite that. We try to be the one that can understand better. We bring it down to a personal level, where we understand a little bit more. We love just a little bit deeper. Do we understand that that's what we're doing when we go against God's word? And I don't know if we do. On so many of these issues, when God says, this is what God said, this is how God feels, and this is what we should do, and we go, I don't know. I think maybe in this situation with these people that I love or with me who I really want to do this, I'm going to go ahead and do it the other way. What we're saying is, you are not credible, and your word cannot stand up underneath itself. And I think that part of it is we don't even know that that's what we're doing. That's what we're causing other people around us to see when we question who he is. The other one is standards. God's moral standard flows from his perfectly pure and holy nature. Since his nature is unchanging, his standard is absolute. This is why we have to know who God is, right? He's so vast and he's so wonderful that we can never know all of who he is. But is God knowable? Yes. Is God knowable?
Yes.
Yes, he is. He's knowable. So what do we have to do? Do we have to climb the highest mountains and have the deepest conversations to feel like we can understand even a bit of who God is? No.
Pursue his word.
That's exactly right. That's how we know who he is. Is his character something that we cannot ever find out? No. It's in his word. It's what he says. It's who he is. We learned about this already in John when we talked about it, that the word is life. That's it. In and of itself is life and completion. That's what we have to lean on. So this, most of what I want to talk about today, I wanted to give some of that, the absolutes of who God is, about his character, about his attributes, that we can rest in, that we can lean on, in order to be able to come to the main topic, which is truth. That's really what I want to talk today about, is truth. And you know what's funny, is I was looking up the definition for truth, and they define truth by truth. Well, truth is truth. Okay, when you define a word by its own meaning, but it's funny that truth nowadays in our culture has a lot of different meanings, and you look it up in the dictionary, and you're like, what page am I on? Who wrote this? This, you know, this Merriam-Webster really is going downhill. I did find this quote that I thought was interesting, and I want you to think about it. In 1979, Arthur Leff, a Yale law professor, spoke at Duke University and expressed how torn human beings are over this issue of absolute truth and the desire for it and the hatred for it we all feel. I want to believe, and so do you, in complete, transcendent, and imminent set of propositions about right and wrong, findable rules that authoritatively and unambiguously direct us how to live righteously. I also want to believe, and so do you, in no such thing, but rather that we are wholly free not only to choose for ourselves what we ought to do, but to decide for ourselves, individually and as a species, what we ought to be. What we want, heaven help us, is simultaneously to be perfectly ruled and perfectly free. This is, at the same time, to discover the right and wrong and the good and to create it. Do you think that's identifiable at all? This crux of the human condition. And I think that's part of the, if we don't know who he is and the attributes of God, and we don't know what he says and the character of God, I think that's exactly where we fall in the cracks. We want to be perfectly ruled when it is a good thing to be perfectly ruled. We want to be perfectly free when I want to be perfectly free. However, how do we do both? I think Jesus said a little something about that, having a double mind, speaking out of both sides of our mouth, not standing someplace, being lukewarm. God doesn't really like that. Jesus with the Pharisees, right? We see these pictures. So, and the next blank is absolute truth is true regardless of how a person thinks or feels about it. And I'm wondering, because again, we're talking to Christians, the world acts like the world. The world is part of the system of their father, who is the devil, we know that. But this isn't the standard that we're talking about the world. This is the standard we're talking about in Christendom, in the church. And I guess part of it is the frustration over how we can have so many people in one room that love the Lord, that are studying the scriptures, and yet we just can't seem to agree on a daggone thing. We have so much struggle and strife within us. It's absurd. Why is it absurd? It's absurd because we are going on our own behalf and not the Maker's. Because we have our own feelings and our own thoughts and we've created our own truth, and guilty myself of how we do some of these things. We get so stuck in our own path that we forget to say, did God say that? What did God say about this? And who is he? And what does his character say? And who am I supposed to be in relation to that? And of course, we know that this world says that everybody is right in their own eyes, and the Bible describes this as the fallen state of man. I did see this, another quote about moral relativism, which I think is very interesting, because as the truth, and you guys hear it all the time, whether you're in public circles, whether you're even a lot of times in the church is getting smaller and smaller with what truth is, but it's what? Listen to my truth. Well, maybe that's their truth. And we think that we can function as a society with you having your truth and me having my truth, because at some point, somebody's truth is going to invade on somebody else's truth.
Which makes it a lie.
And then where do we go from there? I thought this was interesting. Modern humanistic Western society proudly will not openly admit the tendency in human nature to think and do wrong, right? A lot of times we want to say, you do you. You do what's best for you. But really, is that really what we think at the heart of it? Many of their practices indirectly admit this leaning towards wrong is human nature. For example, a promise is not enough. Instead, we need a contract to force others to be honest. Laws are not enough. We need thousands of police and various punishments to enforce them. The payment of fares is not sufficient. Instead, tickets have to be given, inspected, and collected. So we might be saying one thing in order to satisfy our human nature, and again, this would be hopefully outside of the church, but really our laws and our practices say totally otherwise. What does it say? I don't trust you or your judgment. And we have a conflict of interest here, don't we? We have a huge conflict where everybody's going every other way, because when we say we want our own truth and we say we don't want absolute truth, that's actually what we want, but we just want it for ourselves. We just want for you to say that what I'm doing and what I want is okay. However, in the Christian, it's not going to work. This is why we have what we have in the circles that we have going on, and that's why I would very much like to see that God work through all of us to have a culture of truth, which is going to bring peace, because God is truth. And this is what, and the next point I have is that truth is fixed forever. It's forever fixed. Authentic Christianity has always held that Scripture is absolute, objective truth. John MacArthur said that. So when I was doing some research for this, a lot of the things that came up, of course, are all of these terms. Philosophically, you can just go into a whole well of, which my dad said, told me a joke. He's like, well, and he's like, that's a deep subject. It's like, that's so funny. I've never heard that before.
You're such a shallow mind.
I didn't hear that. He was nice to me. Are these terms of objective truth and relative truth? And I would really like to propose to you that in reality, it's objective truth and relative opinion. That we can have thoughts, we can have things that we prefer, but as far as having two facts of objective fact, objective truth, and relative truth, it's not, we don't think that exists. You guys with me?
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting. Okay. So objective truth is truth for everyone, whether they believe it or not. Objective truth, the sky is blue. Objective truth, the grass is green. Of course, nowadays you have objective truth that there are boys and girls. We don't have that. I mean, we do, but we don't. And again, I'm not talking about, we expect that the culture is going to be the culture. The world is going to be the world. We have to look at where we are as a church and as individuals. I was hearing the other day that they have litter boxes in some schools. Because kids identify as cats and dogs. So, you know what? Somebody said that that was okay. Here's the problem with that. That's hurtful to the person that they're allowing it to.
And the janitor.
I don't even know how you would do that.
He changes the boxes.
But see, that's the thing is, what happens when we don't have absolute truth and we think, well, we're being graceful to you. We're giving you grace. No, what you're doing is you're robbing them of God's design. We're willfully robbing them of God's design. And that's a lie of Satan. Did he really say that? Did he really do that? Are we a little bit more loving than God? And God says, really? Those parameters I put in place because I love them, because I made them, because I want to protect them, and I want to guide them to me. And we say, well, I don't know. They're real sad right now. And that's the unfortunate part of the human condition, is when we don't know the Word, when we don't know the character of God, we make bad choices. Because guess what? Any choice that was ever made that was good was because of God, because of the character of God. I got a gal in my class, and she's, I don't know if it was therapized. She's super into therapy. And she said, out loud to the class, she said, every single one of you need to be in therapy. She said, don't disagree. But she said, every single one of you need to be in therapy, because that's where you get the answers.
Oh.
And I said, I don't disagree with you about the therapy part, because I never want to put whatever God has some working on somebody. However, there is no truth from any mouth that didn't come from God.
That's right.
There's no substance, there's no direction, there's no answer, there's no manipulative, there is nothing that didn't come from God. Nobody created it, nobody thought it up, no therapist said the right thing at the right time, but you know what? God did. And God then can enable people to be able to express that truth to other people. That's the truth. That's what truth is. That's what absolute is. And then we know, of course, so absolute truth is it's true for everybody, and it's true all the time. Relative truth is it's true for you, it's true for you, and what's true for me is true for me. Situational ethics, it's part of that kind of deal, where I can tell you, well, it's not okay that you kill somebody, but I think that I should reserve the right to do so. That's relative situational ethics, it's relative truth. However, when we have both of those, to me, they're still contradictory. I don't understand how you can have objective truth for everybody and a subjective truth. There's only one truth. It either is true or it's not. So we can have thoughts and opinions and we can be different, but not when it comes as Christians to the Holy Spirit and what he is saying through the Word of God. And I think that's where we need to ask the Lord to have a soft heart for that, so that he can show us and he can guide us, because he wants to. It's not trickery. It's not something that we have to hold the line to. He's saying, I put it down here. I lived the life and I let you know about it. It's right here for the taking. And you know what I find about all of this is I think that there's a confusion that this absolute truth is somehow from a rigid God that just wants to be able to control things. And it comes off in a very negative manner. I find it extremely graceful. And I put this down when I was thinking about it, that God has done us a great mercy by continually pointing out his perfect absolute truth. Because God forbid we start to think that we are capable or qualified in containing or conjuring truth. What's that?
I said that's what Satan did.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And all we are supposed to do is be partakers of his truth. But I thought, what a great mercy that God said, I have outlined it. I have showed you my character. I have showed you who I am. I have told you what the truth is, because I am completely unadulterated and perfect truth. And you know what, Bethany? All you have to do is live in it. You don't have to make it. God doesn't ask me to make up the rules, and thank good he doesn't, because I can't do it. So what grace and mercy of a father that says, this is the world and here it is. I have showed it to you. I have outlined. I have lived it. And all you have to do is be in it with me. Partake in it. Partake in the truth. I actually found this as another quote, which I thought was very interesting. There's one reason why God and his church are so unpopular. They represent absolute claims on people's minds, wills, and emotions. If God exists, we are not God. If God is true, then we cannot decide what truth is. It's out of our hands, and we have no say in it. We have no vote. The universe is not a democracy. It's a terribly old-fashioned absolute monarchy. I find it super comforting. I don't know about you guys. I mean, I think that within my own human nature, I've done it enough. I have done it enough to know that myself only produces results that are painful, that are hurtful, that don't make sense, that are asinine, that's what I know. But then I have a merciful God that said, Bethany, you don't do any of that. You do not create truth. All you have to do is stand by my truth. And I've outlined it right here for you because he's merciful. Do I have to take that on my own shoulders? I do not. You know why? Because his yoke is light. His burden is light. We give it to him. He'll hold on to that. We do it. We have that opportunity to be able to say, I'll live in it. I'm just going to live in your truth. That's all he asks us to do as disciples. Follow me. Just to follow Christ. And you know what? Is it hard? Yeah. Is it going to be difficult when we have to stand on truth? It will be. Because what happens? Our flesh gets involved. We don't like it. It hurts our feelings. We never like to be at odds with people. We don't like people to not like us. I don't think anybody has ever said, I really enjoy when people do not like me. I think it's very fancy. No, nobody likes that. However, it is something that happens. And that's the cost we have to pay. We don't have to pay the cost of the cross. We don't have to pay the cost of truth. What we have to do is we have to pay the cost of standing next to a Savior that has created us, that has given us the guideline, that has molded us and has saved us. And the good king, I'll pay that cost. Because guess what? It gets reimbursed in heaven. Amen. He reimbursed that cost that we pay here. It's so worth it. Let's see. Oh, you're right. I'm right there. Okay, and so the next one is, it's the last one, is that biblical truth does not change over time, it does not trend, and it cannot become less true. So I don't know if you'll ever have, me and Dottie know this, hashtag trending. I don't think so. I just don't think trending that if you don't believe you're going to go to hell. I just don't think that's ever going to happen. However, it doesn't make it any less true because of the Savior that's on the other side of that beckoning us to come. So in all of this, how do we create a culture of truth? That's really what it comes down to. And what it comes down to is who God is. And how much of that are we going to live in? Because we can't live in a little bit of God and a little bit of his truth and a little bit of us. In order to be able to have a true culture where we get together and we can talk about truth, as we're going to have to die to ourselves, we're going to have to take up our cross, we're going to have to get in the Word, and we're going to have to know Him. We're going to have to know who He is. It's kind of like our kids. You know, sometimes if they make bad choices and they do something, and I'll say, why in the world would you do that? Oh, well, you know, I didn't think it was a big deal. Do you not know your mother? Do you know? And they go, yeah. Do you think your mother would have thought it was a big deal?
Yeah.
Why did you do it? Well, I wanted to. And you know what? I can live with that. I can live with the truth of it. And here's the thing. We need to be able to know the Father so much in His character that when something comes up, we can go, that doesn't sound like Dad, like Mom. That doesn't sound like that. Because I know the character of God, but we can only find that in the Word. In the Word of God, and rest on His principles and who He is. So I thought this quote was pretty good. And I hope that this was an encouragement to you. It's, of course, an indictment on our flesh, right? It's always an indictment in dying to our flesh. However, the King and the Master, the Creator of the universe, has outlined it for us. He paid the price. And He said, come with me. And you know what? I want to go with Him. And it's so good that I can lay down all of this. I don't have to be responsible for it. I just have to follow. I just have to follow. So the last quote on here, so we believe Christians must speak the truth. If millions of Christians keep sowing seeds of truth in millions of conversations and in PTA meetings and political caucuses and classrooms and board meetings and talk shows and public forums and sermons and books and essays and articles and in letters, there will be a leavening effect that will shape ideas and restrain bad behavior and lead people towards light. Let's pray towards that end. Let's pray towards that end, that don't ever give up in God's truth, because He created it. He's the maker of it. We can be a reflector. We're a reflector of God's truth, and we live in it. Let's stand for that. And the last thing I just wanted to point out is that we have to know our Savior. And when it comes about, when it says cultivating, I wanted to look that up really quick. And it's to raise or assist the growth by tilling or by laboring here. Guys, it's going to cost us something. But it's worth the cost if we're believers in Christ. Because let me tell you, there is no peace, there is no joy outside of who He is. Everything else is fake, everything else is a fraud, and it will lead you to places that will take you farther than you want to go and keep you longer than you want to stay. So let's cultivate the ground. Let's work at it, because God has given us an example and an outline, and let's do that together. Wouldn't it be nice to just call things like they are? Just call truth what truth is, and call lie what lie is. I think it's exactly what God wants us to do, because God is good all the time, and all the time. God is good. Very good. Let's pray. Oh dear Lord, I'm just so thankful for Your truth. I'm so thankful for that this broken vessel, God, that You know that I am, and all of the struggles that I have, and everything that I continually go to You for, Lord, that I will be going to You until the day I get home, which I can't wait. But God, I'm just so grateful that You're here to say, here it is, and here's the truth. You have not left us alone. You have not left us to guess. You have not left us to disguise or manipulate things in our own. You have given us it all. You've given us the manual. You've given us the truth. And God, I'm so grateful for that. Help us to live in Your truth. No matter what it costs us, God, that we want to know that right in the middle of Your truth and who You are is peace and joy. And all of the fruits of the Spirit come from that, God. I'm so grateful. And I'm so thankful for You. And I love You. In Your name, amen.